warm on this cold, chilly evening in Calcutta. It's ironic that in a country like ours, where I think we have very little regard for our history when it comes to preservation, when it comes to documentation, history becomes such a sensitive topic, even in the political arena, and it has become a turf war between contesting ideologies for a very long time. And why not? Because as was famously said, he who controls the past controls the present and the future. And there's this other famous saying which says, till the time the lions find their own storyteller, the story of the hunt will always glorify the hunter. So I think there is a growing need for subaltern voices, for different stories which had been suppressed for the longest period of time to now start coming into prominence. Now, in the interest of time, I'll pose a series of questions to these two eminent historians on my left and right. And it's both symbolic and probably ideological as well. And I'm sitting right in the center First of all, let us know, Meenakshi ji, do you think history is a battlefield, as the session has been titled?
Namaskar. Is the mic on?
Yeah.
Okay. I think it will be a little premature to call it a battlefield, though the debate on history has been joined very seriously for the first time in 50 years. And sitting in the city of Calcutta, I would like to recall the role played by several eminent historians from this city, R.C. Majumdar, Jadunath Sarkar, among others, who presented us a very, very comprehensive and complete view of developments in Indian history. Unfortunately, what happened was that about 50 years ago, when the Congress government was in need of minority support, to survive in office, it handed over the education ministry to Professor Nurul Hassan, and that is when the kind of history that was represented by Jadunath Sarkar, R.C. Majumdar, was absolutely erased from all school and college textbooks. In Delhi University, Jawaharlal Nehru University, and Aligarh Muslim University, you would not find the books of any of these historians in the college or university libraries. So what is, you are talking about a battlefield, so it was actually one school that really occupied the whole space beginning in the 1970s. For the last 10-15 years, we have had a very strong comeback by people who have, through their individual efforts and without any state patronage or government help, tried to present a counter narrative. And I would like to just mention some debates on which this school of thought has made remarkable progress. First of all, on the Aryan invasion debate, now the situation is such that the old theory that there was an Aryan invasion is no longer even espoused by those who were its principal architects. Now they are modifying their position and talking about Aryan migration. Similarly, on the role of iconoclasm in Indian history, this was a subject which was not touched upon for the last 50 years. It was taboo. But remarkably, in the context of what happened in Ayodhya and the Ram Janmabhoomi, this issue has also come back center stage. And I would like to give the example of Veer Savarkar, who was a much reviled figure in academic circles for the last five decades. And since Vikram, his book has come out, that book has changed the terms of discourse forever. We cannot argue in the same way again. So what I would like to answer your question by saying, it is not a battlefield because there are not enough foot soldiers, but it is a state of, the state is that enough generals or individuals have entered the fray and won strategic victories.
Thank you. So what view would you have on this? Has there been, and I ask this also in the context that we are sitting in Calcutta and there's this famous book by Arun Shori, eminent historians, in which there is this entire chapter where in, I think in 1987, there was the Bengal government, the then Marxist government, which brought out this circular, which spoke about, you know, ashuddho and shuddho, you know, the pure and impure elements of history in textbooks, where any reference to, you know, invasions, to destruction of temples and all these references needed to be expunged from the history textbooks as ashuddho, only in the interest of, you know, probably preserving national unity and harmony between between societies. But do you think this whitewashing of history, if I may use that term, is the prerequisite for social harmony between communities today? Or we let people know what had happened, and anyone in contemporary India is not responsible for whatever happened in the past, and let those wounds heal? There should be a truth and reconciliation commission, so to say, like what happened in South Africa, and let us move on from there rather than fester wounds. I would love to hear your thoughts, sir, on this.
Well, first of all, I must admit that I am not truly speaking a historian. I am a political scientist who, of course, is conversant with the history of philosophy and the history of ideas. Perhaps that is why the organizers have given me the opportunity to say a few words in this seminar. Now, to start with, I must make it clear to you what I mean by history. History is like a stream ever flowing and continuously changing its courses. Yet history is not like a stream, for a river does not take into account what is left behind, but history makes a faithful record of what is left behind. Secondly, history is absolutely neutral. It has no bias to anyone. That is the second point. Those historians who are engaged in writing history in modern times often are found to be influenced by their respective biases for their ideologies. But I do think that a historian should not have any ideological bias. He should be a neutral observer, because his task is to uncover the things which happened in the past and which are happening at the moment before the eyes of the people. Now, theme is history a new battleground? I must tell you, as far as I know Western history, that history has been continuously a battleground. That applies to India as well, provided you give any historical value to the two great epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata. As you know, these are also accounts of great struggles and battles. But there could be not only the battle between different people, between different races, between different countries, that could also be a battle with different ideas. For instance, I will give you an example. Plato, the ancient philosopher, he wrote a treatise on philosophy for a definite purpose. His purpose was to meet the challenges put up by the sophist philosophers of his time. And this way it continued until democracy was established in the world. But in the early part of 20th century, a challenge came before history. Western history, in the sense that socialism arrived in Russia by virtue of the revolution in 1917, and accordingly there started a battle of ideologies, socialism or democracy, which is acceptable. Meanwhile, I must tell you that history has been viewed in different ways. There were some like Carlyle who thought that history was just an account of the glorious activities of some extraordinary individuals. But Baudin, the French philosopher of 16th century, he for the first time emphasized the fact that history is not a history of individuals. History is a history of the whole people. It's an account of the way of life, including the geographical, climatic, psychological, and other conditions into account. Now, this was further developed by Karl Marx in his historical materialism. He wrote at the start of his historical materialism that history is not a history of some individuals, it is a history of the whole people. That is, it is a history of society, including all. Unfortunately, though I do not subscribe totally to Marx's historical materialism, I found that many historians of our country, they gave emphasis on the elite activities of different centuries. But the commoners, particularly the people of the lower stratum, they were neglected. Ranjit Guha, Professor Ranjit Guha, for the first time, he brought out a new thesis, and that was the thesis on subalterns. He said that history should take into account the stories of subalterns who have been totally neglected.
So
I may point out that before Ranjit Guha, long ago, a Bengali literature, I do not know whether you know his name, he is Prabodhonath Bishi. He wrote a novel, Ashwatthamer Itihas. In that novel, he developed three paragraphs which represent the essence of subaltern historical studies. Now today, we take history as a history of the whole people, including the subalterns. That is the meaning of history.
I'll take it back to Meenakshi ji, and I think my question remains about Indian historiography and how that has been written, particularly in the last 50 years, as you mentioned. And you have done seminal work on particularly an issue which is of contemporary relevance politically, socially, which is on the Ayodhya, Ram Janmabhoomi, Babri Masjid case. In that, in particular, Meenakshi ji, in brief, if you could tell us, what was the role played by historians to frame the case in the way it was, and what your research findings showed?
Yeah, before I come to that, since the issue of subalterns has been raised, I would like to say, and you mentioned this very famous quote, till the lions have their own historians. I would like to place on record the fact that India is perhaps unique among world civilizations where political power was not in the hands of the people of the subcontinent, and in spite of that, there is so much evidence that they have recorded and left of their situation in those times. So for example, I'll just come to your question, but I want to say, we all have heard of Mahmud Ghaznavi, but how many of us know that there was a contemporary account of Mahmud Ghaznavi in India? And I can give many such instances. Right from the time of Mahmud Ghaznavi, we have eyewitness accounts of stalwarts of society at that time. People who were ministers, people who were rulers, they left eyewitness accounts of what they experienced, what their region experienced at this time. So in India, when we say that the subalterns, we had to wait for historians to write about subalterns is actually not absolutely accurate, because the subalterns, the so-called subalterns, were writing their history at that time when it was being enacted in front of their eyes. What has happened is a tragedy that we have forgotten these sons of the soil, these proud sons of the soil, who took great risks to record, because we don't hear of them and we don't study about them. Now to come to Ayodhya. Ayodhya is important because all the evidence that we had, which strengthened the case for a temple at that site, was preserved by people whom we can call subalterns. It was not preserved by kings or, powerful people. It was preserved, and this evidence was so strong that finally the Supreme Court had to say that the Babri Masjid party was not able to produce one bit of evidence to show that they were present at that site for 300 years. From 1528, they were not able to provide any evidence. The first evidence they are able to provide is in 1856. So for three centuries, there is nothing to substantiate their presence, which means that it could have been a smash and grab affair. You smash that place, grab it, and then you disappear, because there's probably no population of your faith which can sustain that site. So the evidence is so remarkable. I don't want to get into all the details of the evidence, though I'll just mention the first evidence that we have of a masjid presence at that site is within 80 years of the demolition of that mandir. Then it's an eyewitness account of a foreigner who came to India, visited that place, and wrote an account of how he finds people coming to that place, worshipping and doing parikrama at that site. The second evidence is by a Jesuit father who lived in India for 40 years and even died in India. And he wrote a very deep, he was a polymath, he was so skilled in so many fields. And he wrote an account. And in that account, he has actually provided even sketches of that site. And he said that there is a bedi that has been created. Bedi or vedi means cradle, cradle for a newborn. And he says that on the occasion of Ram Navami, lakhs of people come here and do parikrama. So that is two eyewitness accounts, which they didn't realize would be regarded as crucial evidence. And after that, from 1858, when the British judicial system came into operation in the city of Ayodhya, from 1858 till 1947, there are so many cases which the Mahants of the Janamsthan filed against the superintendent of the masjid, saying that, you know, this is what is happening to us. So all this evidence, it was conclusive proof that there was a continuing presence of a large community when political power was not in the hands of their community. They were still taking great risk. And these are subalterns, whom we would call subalterns. They were coming to that area on particular days, which were regarded as very holy in their faith, and coming and doing parikrama around a cradle which they had built. And a cradle is always palna, or for a newborn child.
Sir, before I throw it open to the audience for their reactions, I'd like to ask you that particularly a subject like history, there are no absolutes. Everything is, a famous historian in the West had called it, every account of history is an interim report. So every generation looks back, there is new research, and something new comes up. But when I specifically talk of Indian historiography, do you think there has been a space for contesting viewpoints, or there has been a thraldom or a capture of the narrative, so to say, by just one strain of thought or one narrative? What would be your views on that before I throw it open to the audience?
Well, Indian historians, I find, they are mostly used to collecting their materials from documents, documented evidences. That is, they view documents as the genuine evidence of history. But I'm afraid this is not a correct approach. I remember whenever in my young age I was a student at London School of Economics, in my first class on political science, I found that Gulliver's travels are being taught by the teacher as a part of the syllabus. I was extremely surprised. And then I spoke to the professor, my professor, and he gave a long lecture to me personally. He said, history should also collect materials from wherever it can be collected. For instance, literature is an important source of history. Unfortunately, India, there has not been any evidence to collect materials from history. When I was attending Nikhil Bharat Bongo Sahitya Sammelan as its main president, I talked to them, the audience, and I gave some evidences how we get history from the Bengali literature. For instance, I cited Tarashankar Bandyopadhyay's Kalindi. In that Kalindi, he shows how capitalism, how the conflict is going on between capitalism and feudalism, and ultimately capitalism wins. Again, in his Hasuli Bake Rupakatha, he has a part devoted to the conflict between tradition and modernity. There, the traditional idea is that the leader of a particular community is invincible. Banwari is the leader, and he has a young wife, very young, compared to Banwari's age, very young. Well, almost a girl of 20 or 22 years, and Banwari is about 60 years old. But Paki fell in love with someone, a young man, who was working in a factory in the nearby town. Now, one day while Paki was expressing her love to his lover under a tree, under the shadow of a tree, it is evening, Banwari suddenly saw them. Banwari immediately jumped on that, but Bilas, his name, jumped on him, and they started fighting with each other. They came down the banks of the river, and Paki could see none of them. Sometime later, Paki saw that a man, almost invisibly, is coming, trembling, with his body totally trembling. She was absolutely sure that Banwari has killed his lover, Bilas. But when the gentleman came before him, she was surprised to see it was not Banwari, it was that Bilas. That Bilas represents modernity, which drastically crushes all traditional values, and the community leadership also undergoing a change. Mm. This is an instance. That means what I mean to say, Indian historians never try to collect materials from the non-formal sources.
Yeah.
They always collect their materials, formal sources. That is why they write the history they write is never complete.
So the debate on history and what is history, what is true history, I think that would continue to plague us for a very long time. But before we close, I'd certainly, because it's a topic that generates a lot of passion, a lot of interest, I'd certainly request anyone from the audience, if they have questions. I think we have time for two questions. Is there anyone who would want to ask? The lady at the back, please.
Namaste. I just wanted to ask, it's quite apparent that history in some way has been misappropriated or probably given more or less weightage in our textbooks.
He's asking you to come forward.
Oh. Please come forward so that I can see you properly.
Oh, okay. I thought you could. Okay. I just have a question that it's quite apparent that history does seem to have been misappropriated in some way or probably given weightage according to the narrative building which has suited a certain block or a clique of people. Yeah. So now what? I mean, because whenever we shouldn't rewrite history, but in order to also do away with this misappropriation, how do we deal with it? Can we have an apolitical, a completely neutral body like an UGC who will apportion, you know, certain portions of history rightfully and give them justice? What now? What sure. plans okay. should the government okay. have?
Got your question. Now? Just one more question and I'll toss it on to both the eminent historians here. Anyone else has a question? Yeah? I think we've been very clear. Yeah, so Meenakshi ji, what
so,
would...
And what I want I'll, to say...
Let's keep it short yeah. and brief so that...
Yeah. yeah, as you said, appropriation. The appropriation of school textbooks has continued. The textbooks that were there from the 1960s till the first NDA government were written by leading historians of the left, if I can use that term. In the first BJP government, the textbooks were replaced. But within the first week of UPA 1 coming back, those textbooks were rejected and thrown out. And the textbooks that are there now have been in circulation for 10 years of UPA 1 and 2 and 5 years of NDA. And this is the sixth year. So what I want to say that what you call appropriation continues till this day, and there has been no rectification. And I just want to make one point. The appropriation is designed to wipe out or remove any memory of glorious epics of our glorious epochs of our history. I'll just give one example and hand it over. For example, the class 7th textbook does not mention Krishnadevaraya. Krishnadevaraya was one of the leading lights of Indian history, and he was a towering personality, and there is no just, he is not mentioned, and there is hardly any discussion on the Vijayanagar Empire. So that will give you some idea of how the misappropriation, as you call it, continues, and we still have a long way to go.
So while I request you, sir, I mean, as we speak, there is a debate that goes on Savarkar, on the Congress version, the BJP version. So I think echoing the sentiments of the lady there, will we continue to keep talking about Marxist history, a saffron history, a desaffronization, or will there be ever a point in Indian historiography where there'll be actual history, which is to the extent possible true and uncolored by all these toxic political ideologies on the left and the right, which the young generation of this country can actually understand where they came from? Do you see any hope for that at all? Or given the political toxicity of today, that seems a distant dream.
As far as India is concerned, I'm not very hopeful at all. On the contrary, I'm shocked because I find the ruling class always tries to remake history. As I said earlier, history is neutral. It does not glorify anyone.
But historians are not.
Historians are not. The history itself, it does not glorify anyone, nor minimize the role of anyone. It gives a very faithful and neutral account. But I find in India, and also in my state, that the ruling class is trying to develop some historians who will work as their stooges, and they are trying to incorporate certain things within textbooks to be read by the students, some events which go in their favor. I'll give one or two examples. For instance,
one may be good because I think we're running time's up has flashed on the screen, and so is our moderator here. Yeah. yeah. Yes.
Go on.
Yeah. So I think this would be a debate which would never
now,
end.
Complete. Yeah. Now take the example of Savarkar. Okay. Now at the moment, among the politicians, I find there have been two groups. One, glorifying Savarkar, another, debunking Savarkar. Now, why so? Because history faithfully gives an account of Savarkar's life and activities. In his early life, how many of you, I do not know, that in his early life, he was a revolutionary believing in armed struggle. And that's why he went to London to learn the techniques of making bombs and other arms. Suddenly, he was caught by the London police. He was arrested. And then they were bringing him to India on a ship. When the ship reached near the port of Calais, the French port, Savarkar jumped from the ship. And by swimming very quickly, he reached the shore. He found a French policeman standing there. He went to him and said, "You arrest me," because he thought that if the French police arrests him, he will be able to have asylum in France. The French police did not act, and eventually the British police again arrested him and took him to India, and for which he was sentenced to transportation.
Amal Babu, I understand that this discourse is very interesting, but unfortunately we have another session.
Sorry, I'll add one point. You see, one point, whenever he was in Andaman, in cellular jail, he wrote a letter to the British government requesting them to release him from his transportation, and he gives the undertaking that he will not be engage himself in any further freedom struggle of India. He did it, that is also a fact. Now it is for the people to judge, not the historians, not the political leaders. All right.
Thank you so much, Amal Babu.
I think this debate shall not end and it shall continue.
I know,
maybe
but it's very interesting
have
for
this
sure.
Several in the next edition as well. History finally is the handmaiden of the ruler. So the one who holds the sword is also the one who writes the history. So on that count, thank you to both the eminent historians for this wonderful session. Thank you. Kojo, kojo. Kojo, kojo. Kojo, kojo. Kojo, kojo.